Good morning, church family. I'm so glad that you have taken time to focus your hearts on our Lord this morning. I know we're gathering from all over, but we are gathering together in our Lord. This morning, I wanted to do the announcements at the beginning of the service during our countdown. So here's what's happening here within our congregation this week. Just a reminder that if you have any prayers or praises that you would like to have on Sunday morning, you can call the church, you can text me, or you can email me at gccoffice@sbcglobal.net. And we'll be able to share those with our whole congregation, our whole family next week. The diaper drive for the Caring for Women Pregnancy and Resource Center is finishing up at the end of this month officially. But we still have a few days, and we may even have an extra week, depending upon how things are going, to be able to bring down some diapers and wipes to help just support this wonderful ministry that we have in our area. Also, just a quick reminder that your tithes and offerings can be brought to the church or mailed to the church, or you can have someone come by and pick them up. So please remember that this is a part of our worship, and I've just been so encouraged by the number of people that are continuing to give in these different ways from what we're used to. I also wanted to remind you that our greeting time is coming up during the service, and plan now to send a text of encouragement during the greeting time to different people in the church or even others during this time so that they are reminded of the depth of love that our Lord has for us. Also, just so people all know, our men's prayer and Bible study is still continuing on here at the church on Tuesdays at 9:30 a.m. So men that have been coming, I know there are not very many of you because of all that's going on, but it's just been so great for those that have been coming and the time we've been able to share. We also have our Wednesday Bible study that we put on hold. But because of the technology we have available to us, we're going to give it a try this Wednesday to see if we can continue the study on Wednesday at 7 p.m. If you want to be part of this study, give me a call at the church, 846-4002, or send me an email, and I will get you a link that what is needed so that we can have our Bible study talking about the risen Christ, Jesus' final words on earth together. So as this countdown continues, let's prepare our hearts to worship our Lord.
Clean heart, oh God.
Let's read together Psalms chapter 9, verses 1 and 2. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, Most High. morning, church. Isn't it great that we're able to, even in the middle of this coronavirus stay-at-home order situation that we're in, that we can still worship our Lord? Just because we're not gathering in the church building does not mean that the church is not gathering. And it seems to me that as a church body, we are reaching out and finding ways to encourage, support, and love each other that we never even thought of before. I don't know about you, but that is encouraging to me. We are here today to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the only true Savior. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, I thank you for this church family. This church family that we have that is beyond the walls of our building, even beyond our immediate community. But our church family goes from pole to pole throughout the entire world. Father, today we are gathering in many places to worship you. We're gathering in groups. We're gathering individually. And we have the privilege to be able to worship you and to focus on you and to glorify your name. As we begin this morning to turn our hearts to worship you, Father, help us to set aside the distractions of this world, the problems of this world, the attractions of this world, and focus on you and you alone. Father, we lift up to you our hearts. We come to you to worship you and give you all glory, honor, and praise. Father, this is our prayer in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.
Always by my side. Hearts always hunger for. this hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore.
Good morning, church. Wherever you are, be the church and the witness of Jesus Christ. The story of Mephibosheth, the story of us. This is one of those beautiful stories in the Old Testament that became a picture of the future story of the New Testament. The story of us, the story of Jesus, our King, the King of Kings. 2 Samuel chapter 4 reads like this: Jonathan, son of Saul, had a son who was lame in both feet. He was 5 years old when the news about Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel. His nurse picked him up and fled. But as she hurried to leave, he fell and became crippled. His name was Mephibosheth. This is the story of Mephibosheth in one verse. But of course, if you would like to learn more about him, read 2 Samuel chapter 9, 13 verses. Key verse in that passage is verse 10, the latter part of the verse. And I give you other optional scriptures, chapter 16 and same book, 2 Samuel, verses 1 through 4, chapter 19, 24 through 30, key verse 26. Reading these verses will further your understanding of this story. Mephibosheth means exterminator of shame or exterminator of idols. That's a pretty good title for a man who became crippled. 2 Samuel 9:10b. And Mephibosheth, grandson of your master, will always eat at my table. The greatest of declarations from the viewpoint of a king, King David. That is King David at his best, talking about Mephibosheth, the son of his best friend, who was killed with his father, also a king, Saul, as we know him. Now, this was the story of Mephibosheth that became the story of us, like Mephibosheth. Let's go to the New Testament. Jesus, one of many of Jesus' declarations is this: the thief comes only to kill, steal, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. That's John 10:10. Again, the key part, the last part of the verse. We find the moment when Jesus brings this thing that we call communion. Matthew 26, verses 26 through 29, gives this declaration of truth from the lips of King Jesus. Verse 26, he says, in part of the verse, take and eat, this is my body. This, the bread that Jesus took in his hands, is the symbolic representation of his body. It's not literal that people were eating part of his body. It was a, a, picture teaching kind of thing. Verse 27, drink from it, all of you. Again, we're going to find out what was that that he said, drink all of you. Verse 28, he says, this my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. The stuff in the cup is called the fruit of the vine, according to verse 29. It's the symbol of what is to come. And it is from that moment on a covenant blood, Jesus said, giving for the forgiveness of sin. Not sins, not plural, but singular. The sin condition that crippled us from the beginning. The sin condition he wants to cure us from. Again, verse 29. I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. Do you see it? Do you see that? Here is the declaration, but also here is the invitation to go to the king's table when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. What does that mean? Is that, that means that he is already inviting you for that moment that we celebrate every Sunday, the Lord's Supper, the communion. And so he wants you there. It will happen in heaven with King Jesus at the head of the table. And like Mephibosheth, we came to Jesus broken, crippled, hopeless, shameful, hateful, lost, fearful, orphan, and more. But thanks be to God the Father and God the Son, we've been redeemed. We press ourselves, or Jesus calls, into what Jesus called into his life. He invites us to his great supper communion. Just as we are, that is how he takes us. Just as we are. The invitation is personal to him, and it should be personal to us. Let's pray. Father, thank you. You are such a good, loving Father and a Savior. Your Son is a Savior. Thank you for giving your life for us, because we didn't deserve it. But it is such a present that you already deposited in our lives. Your Spirit, the knowledge of salvation, the knowledge of knowing that you're the only one that can rescue us and save us, oh Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for going to the cross and that shame and everything that you went through. Thank you. We didn't deserve it, but your love is magnificent. Thank you again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please repeat with me the Good Confession. I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God.
Thank you.
It's now time to focus our hearts and minds on giving to the Lord. Our giving is different. You can give the offerings through the mail by sending it to the church. You can have someone come and pick it up, give us a call, and we'll send someone to pick it up, or you can bring it down to the church. But it's still important for us every week to focus our hearts on the Lord, that we need to remember that we are part of God's ministry. I just want to read from you 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Our desire is to serve Him. And even in this pandemic, this stay-at-home order, the stresses that we're facing, we can still give thanks in these circumstances. We can thank God for the blessings He has for us. We can find unique ways to share His love. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Father God, thank You. Thank You for the opportunity we have to be involved in Your ministry through this church. Father, I ask Your blessings on the offerings as they come in during the week, as we are gathered together, so that together we can, through this congregation, share the love that You have to those who so desperately need it. Father, I ask Your blessings on those that give and on the gifts. Father, this we pray in Your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.
It's time to for us to bring some prayer requests from the people of the church that they have come in. And the first one is Norma Stone has issues with her stability. She fell, she's using a walker, nothing broke, it's just she will not stay put. Bruce and Donna Hughes are going to Orville a few times a week to do her dialysis. And on Wednesday, she is going to see another of her doctors. So they ask for prayers for that day too. We need to keep our medical personnel and first responders in our prayers. Truck drivers and those providing transportation of goods, meaning to the stores. And the last one is for government leaders and as they make decisions regarding this thing of restarting the country into work. So let's have a word of prayer. those of you that are home, whatever you're doing, put it up for a minute and come together with us in prayer. Oh Father, we come to you again because there are many people, elderly saints, who are struggling, physically struggling. We heard of Norma Stone. We know that Bruce and Donna, it has to be overwhelming, the times that they go to just for her dialysis and how long it takes for her to be there. But on top of that, more doctor's appointments. And so just be with them, guide them, protect them, and always be surround. Your spirit may surround them as they go. Father, we pray for those who are the first ones at scenes where there's more people with this coronavirus. We pray, Father, that your protection is with all of them, that nothing will touch them as they serve the people of this great country. Father, also, we pray for truck drivers that are safe in every load that they take, every route that they take, every county that they go to, that you be with them, Father. Give them the strength they need, and give the leaders of our country, Father, knowledge, insight, wisdom, so that as they make decisions to restart the market of jobs here in this country, they do it thinking and prayerfully about all of this. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
We've been looking forward to having Seth and Marybeth Sponsler from Heaven Hills come and share with us for some time. But because of the coronavirus pandemic and the stay-at-home order that we are all under, they were not able to come. We had planned an after-worship potluck dinner and everything, and yes, I did tell them about the wonderful cooks we have here at Gridley Christian Church, and they were so looking forward to that. But that said, I asked Seth if he could send us a video greeting and a message for us, and he did. Seth and Marybeth came on board at the camp a little under a year ago. They are our camp directors, and they have lived in Soulsbyville, which is near the camp, for years, and they were introduced to the camp by Robbie and Cynthia James, our former directors. Their teamwork this last year with our camp managers, Jameson and Hannah, have been a blessing to our camp. I would say with them working together, the ministry of the camp is already going up to the next level. So let me hand it off to Seth and Marybeth.
Good morning, Gridley. This is Seth and Marybeth Sponsler, and we just want to welcome you guys to this short video teaching. And we're so sorry that we're not able to come up to Gridley and to meet you personally and love on you. And also, Pastor Ed's been talking about the amazing potlucks after church. So we need to come up there as soon as possible when this is all done, because I know that all you great cooks are just dying to love on people. So we'll be up there soon.
Seth and I have been married for 25 years this summer. It's hard to believe it's gone that fast. We have four kids, Josh, Josiah, Jonathan, and Hannah. Our oldest son, Joshua, is married to Madison. They live in Texas, and we're going to have our first grandbaby this summer. We're super excited. Prior to coming to Heavenly Hills, Seth and I have been in full-time ministry since we got married. And the last 10 years, we started a ministry called Bending the Bow, where we provide pastoral care to local in the States missionary leaders and missionaries that are overseas. So that's been a lot of fun. We've traveled with our kids overseas. It's been a great experience for our family, and we love the body of Christ. We love the body of Christ all over the world, and we've learned so much about the kingdom and the different parts of the kingdom, and we now are super excited to be at Heavenly Hills. And we look forward to the day when this quarantine is over and we get to come and meet you guys and greet you in person.
Yeah. Little quick update on Heavenly Hills. We're on a great team with the Glazebrooks, which you guys have met before. We are just doing a lot of updating, a lot of futuristic stuff with internet, getting our paperwork done, getting a lot of the fire stuff, insurance stuff taken care of on the property. And so even though we're not having rentals and we've missed a women's conference, and yet Mary Beth was able to send some videos through the internet, we're moving forward. We're not sure what it's going to look like, but we also just last night finished our staff meeting, and we also did our summer staffing. So we're still moving forward. So we're here. We're waiting and chomping at the bits to love on you guys. But we're taking the time right now to work on a few things. We love your prayers. Mm-hmm. We know God's in control. We know God can move things. We know God can has and can still do put the coin in the fish's mouth at the right time. So mm-hmm. there's a lot of things that he's going to do in this season for Heavenly Hills, for you guys, for your church, for us. Just be taking notes of it, because it's going to be small and it's going to be big at times, but he sees us and he's loving on us. So we just want to say thank you. Welcome. I hope that we can encourage you guys today with a short message. And again, we'll look forward to seeing you guys. And Mary Beth's going to leave right now so I can focus on giving you guys a message.
See you soon.
I'm going to slide over here. I just want you to know we're family. And family can make mistakes. Family doesn't have to be perfect. You guys have not been around me. I have a lot of humor without trying to be funny. One time I was speaking at our church when I was associate pastor, and I was trying to compliment my wife, and I was saying, hey, my wife is just like the Proverbs woman in verse 21. And everybody got deathly silent, started laughing, and I look at Mary Beth in the front row, and she's got a face, a red face and all that. And what I didn't realize that Proverbs 21 talks about the dripping faucet. I was trying to talk about Proverbs 31 woman, because I married way up into an amazing woman. If you're taking notes today, I'm going to talk about battle weariness. And so turn to 1 Samuel 30. It's the whole chapter, verse 1 through 31. I'm going to read a little bit here, and I'm going to give you the context of the story just to set some things up that will make sense and help you. And so here we are, 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 1. And now it happened that David and his men came to Ziklag, and on the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south, and Ziklag attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were with them. From small to great, they did not kill anyone, but carried away them away and went their ways. So David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire, and their wives, their sons, their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. So let's jump down to verse 6. And now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord. And we're going to come back to that. And we're going to jump down to verse 9. So David went, he and his 600 men who were with him, and came to the brook of Bezor, where those who stayed who were left behind. But David pursued, and 400 men, for 200 men stayed behind, who were so weary that they could not cross the brook Bezor. And that's really important in this story here. And then verse 16, we jump down, and then he had brought him down. There were spread out over all the land. And I skipped some stuff, but there was an eunuch, young man from Egyptian, that he was a servant, and he helped David find the Amalekites. And they were eating and drinking and dancing because all the great spoils which they had taken from the land of the Philistines and from the land of Judah. Then David attacked them from twilight until evening of the next day. Not a man of them had escaped except for 400 young men who rode on camels and fled. So David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away, and David rescued his two wives, and nothing of theirs was lacking. Neither small nor great, sons or daughters, spoils of anything which they had taken from them. David recovered all. And then David took all the flocks and herds that they had driven before others' livestock and said, "This is David's spoils." And now David came to the 200 men who had been so wearied that they could not follow David, whom they had also made to stay at the brook Besor. So they went out to meet David and to meet the people who were with him. And then David came near the people, and he greeted them. And then all the wicked and the worthless men of those who went with David answered and said, "Because they did not go with us, we will not give them any of the spoils." And then David recovered, except for every man's wife and children, that they may lead them away and depart. But David said, "My brethren, you shall not do so with what the Lord has given us, who has preserved us and has delivered into our hands the troops that came against us. For who will heed you in this matter? But as his part is who goes down to the battle, so shall the part who stays by the supplies, they shall share alike." So it was from that day forward that he made it a statute as an ordinance for the Israel to this day. Now that was really important in David. And what I want to just share here today with you is that we all get battle weary. We all get tired. We are in a battle of some kind. Even before this crisis with the coronavirus, there's been things going on. This one is just been a little more magnified. This one has been a little more personal at times, but it doesn't take away the real personal things that you're going in with your life. You might be hunkering down. You might not be affected by this. Some people have lost money. Some people have lost jobs. Some people have lost loved ones that have died or sick. And it's just been this swirling. But I want you to put yourself in David's shoes. And just like you're at Gridley right now, and just imagine your guys are in church, and all of a sudden you get surrounded by the enemy. You get attacked, and what do you do? You got a couple choices. You can surrender. You can fight. Some people will be hurt. Some people will be killed. But you got to believe in something to actually move you into a place of doing something. And so David, he's out there fighting with his men. So I'm sure he's thinking about, "Man, I can't wait to get home, get kisses from my wives, get a nice bath, get all this blood off me, get all this dirt, and then have a great meal and enjoy my children and enjoy the spoils." And as they start getting closer and closer, they start seeing smoke, a fire. And I've had that happen here in Sonora. I've had that happen where you don't know if it's your house or your area with a fire, and your heart goes right into your stomach, and you start getting this anxious anxiety on you and this fear. And I'm sure David started walking a little faster, maybe even jogging, maybe even running. And then he gets to his town, and it's burned, everything's gone. And then he tears his clothes, hits the dirt with all the sweat, with all the blood, and he's face down, just weeping and mourning for his loss. But then it gets worse. The men that he believed in, the men that he loved, the men that he served, the men that he wanted to empower and call to greatness, when nobody else believed in them, get this thought. Hey, they're grieving, they're broken, and they want to kill him. And when I look at that story, it's like, just stay down, David. It's okay. It's justified. You're in a tough spot. Your heart's broken. You have no strength to get up. You don't have maybe even any answers. So it's okay. Just stay down. But what it says in verse 6 is that it says that David strengthened himself in the Lord. doesn't say how long it took. It doesn't say what. But I want to propose something to you, that in that time in the dirt, in that time with the tears, in that time in the brokenness, God started showing him and reminding him of what God did for him. As a young boy, when he killed the bear and the lion, as a young boy, when he ran into battle against David, the Goliath. And I think he started showing him the times that he was out there singing songs underneath the stars and watching his father's flock, and the encounters that he had with him. And I think he started replaying. And I think in that moment, there started to become strength. And he started to get something inside of him. I look at it this way, is a few years ago, the Lord was telling me, I got it on my phone as a ring saver, the Rocky music. And I think it was the first movie where Rocky fought Apollo, dating myself, it's probably 30 years ago. And Rocky went into this battle as an underdog. Rocky went in not supposed to win, but he had high hopes, and he had confidence, and he was sure of himself, and he was a good fighter. And from the very get-go, he starts getting his hiney kicked. He, if you're taking score on a piece of paper, he's losing. And then it gets farther into the rounds, and there's no way that he can win on paper unless he gets a KO. But about round 9, 10, 11, he can barely stand up. He's bleeding. He can't see. His coach, his girlfriend, his friends, everybody's saying, stay down, stay down. You're going to die if you get up. You're going to get killed. You're going to get brain damage. You're going to get destroyed if you get up. But something inside of him, his DNA, like David, he just stayed in there, even maybe to a default. And it was a pretty gruesome fight. And then you get into round 12, and you're just hoping that he doesn't die. And then the music plays. And when the music plays, something shifts. And something where he gets a couple shots in, and the whole movie starts changing. To the point where Rocky KOs him and wins. That's been a very important picture for me in what I've been facing, my wife's been facing, our family's been facing, our ministry's been facing for the last 14 to 16 months. And what I'm going to share with you is some of the things that happen when you're battle weary. But one of the things I'm going to also share is what you can do in the middle of the battle. And it's hard to do things in the middle of the battle when you haven't already prepared. So back in 2019, I won't go into all the details, but we just started having a lot of demonic, crazy activity in our community. 5 church splits, the Christian body of Christ eating their own. We call it Christian cannibalism. People throwing God's word out and not applying it to their lives and saying it doesn't fit in this time, which is like, come on, it's your anchor. And I got on a plane back in March last year, and I started seeing stuff. As we'd been in this for about 4 or 5 months, I started seeing some of the things that were happening to me personally. And one of the things was I was losing my focus for the vision of who I was and who God was. I was so tired, so beat up, that I was looking all around because there were so many things coming. Like, when's the next punch coming? Is it coming through the internet? Is it coming through a text? Is it coming from somebody stopping by? It got real personal. Everything was getting challenged. And so it's real easy to lose your focus on who God is and who you are. Number two is I started making mistakes. I stopped living by my list of things to remind me. Now I'm 58. I'm getting older. So, hey, but I was making mistakes. And when I was tired. Number three was I started losing my strength to fight for the future. Like, I know the calling on my life. I know the things that God has spoken. And I was, I know who I'm supposed to be ministering to and loving and encouraging. And I started losing my strength to fight because I was tired. I was beat up. Number four is on our ministry team and in our inner circle of people, we started losing our unity. We started getting disconnected and we were getting fragile, and because we were all in the same boat and we had nobody refreshing us. We had nobody coming together. When you're all in the same boat and you're tired, and you could say this as a husband or a wife or a leadership team or elders, like you're always hoping that somebody's in a good place to help you up when you're not. Like when you're down, you want a hand that reaches down and picks you up. But when you're all in the down on the bottom, it's like there's no help coming. And so we started losing our unity. Number five, we got into survival mode. And survival mode is where a lot of people in this situation, in this crisis, in this season have been. It's all about me. You know, you can have your boat wrecked and you're out in the middle of the ocean and nobody's looking at, hey, come over here and get on my little piece of the wood. It's usually like stay away, find your own, because I know if you come over on my piece of the wood, it's going to sink. And it's what they always say too, is if you got a dog that's in a pool or in a bottle in a water and they're drowning, you don't want to go over there and try to save them. There's certain ways you can save them, but they'll get on top of you and do this and push you down. And that's what survival mode does. And I was learning some of the things that I was doing and what was affecting me. Number six is that we lose our hope that we're on the winning team. If you read the book of Revelations, it always tells us the end results. We win. We just had Easter. Death and the grave did not keep our Savior defeated. He rose on the third day. That's where our hope is. So even though we're passing through, even though we are guaranteed in this life trials, it's not about having a perfect life. It's not about having those things not happening. That's just unrealistic. You can't live because we're human and things happen. So here's some of the things I want to encourage you with. Six things that the Lord started speaking to me. Things that we've forgot at the time. Things that we pulled in. And even with this coronavirus, it has had hit us. Maybe not with the loss of people and stuff like that, but it has hit us and it will continue to hit us. But we're prepared now to go, okay, this is what we know. This is what we've learned. Now we just have to stay anchored to this. Number one, sleep, water, and good food and some kind of physical activity is important. I know my wife calls it the coronavirus diet, but it's not a diet because it's like all you can do is you're sitting, you're hunkering down eating. So we're gaining weight. But water, good food, rest, and some kind of physical activity and not being a couch potato will help you. If you've ever flown on a plane and the stewardess gets on and starts going through their spiel about, hey, in case of emergency, and the mask drop down, they always say, put it over yourself first. With you with infants or traveling with somebody that's older or needs help or assistant. In this season, we have to take care of ourselves or we're not going to be effective to give away and to do and be the hands of Jesus. Number two, we hold on and water daily our God-given anchors to truth. And we declare God's promises, God's written word, and our personal prophetic words, and our history with God over our life situations. Now that's the heart of Samuel in verse 6. We strengthen ourselves in the Lord. We've got to get God's word and the anchors. When the storm comes, everything gets shifted. There is a great shifting and shaking going on. Anything that can be shaken is. And if you're and it's just a good time to like, oh, do I want to just get washed out or do I want to stay here? And what am I grabbing a hold of? What am I anchoring myself to? What am I watering? Whatever you water grows. I love that saying. It's so simple, good or bad in this season. Am I watering the negative? Am I watering the what ifs? Or am I pulling in God's truth to what his word says, what my history is with God and the prophetic, what he has spoken to me, that's what I need to hang on. And I can't hang on with one hand. it's got to be both hands in this season, or I'm going to let go, because there is a great amount of fear and anxiety and the what ifs that just kind of shuffle us. Number three, we live moment by moment in praise, worship, thanksgiving, and gratefulness to our King. Before you get out of bed, and when you go to bed, and all day through the day, moment by moment, lifting His name up, worshiping Him, giving Him honor and glory and praise. Lord, I don't know what You're going to do. I don't know how You're going to do it, but I know that You are going to do it because You're a good God. It's not sticking my head in the sand and denying that there is a reality, but it's I'm grabbing God's truth. I don't want to be like the Israelites and saying, hey, we better go back to Egypt. It was better there than it was being led by the cloud and the fire. And miracle after miracle after miracle, God delivered them and got them into the promised land. But it's got to be moment by moment. We can't let 5 minutes go and we water the what ifs. We water the fear. We water the anxiety. Number four is we keep our inner circle tight. We back into each other and stay connected because we're stronger together. And I call that the herd thing. So if you've ever watched Animal Planet or anything like that, there was a whole thing on YouTube just talking about the water buffaloes when the lions came in. And they put the young and the elderly and the old and the cripple, and that's a whole message in itself. And they just back their hinies in to the center, and they had their horns looking out. And they just ducked their heads, and as the lions came, they were able to get them and get them out of there, and they stayed shoulder to shoulder. The ones that ran, the ones that did it isolation and got isolated and started thinking differently got picked off. Who's your DNA? Who's your herd? Who can you back into? And we're stronger together. We have more resources together when we put them together. This should be a rallying point for us as the body of Christ. We have answers. We have solutions. We have a God that is a good God. And it's not supposed to be, I'm just going to take care of myself so hopefully I can survive this thing. It's kind of like the Alamo. It's like the people in the Alamo knew they weren't going to survive, but they were playing the long game for something bigger that they would never see. And I've had four different Alamos moments in my life that are totally different side note, but who are your inner circle? Who can you back into and contribute and take and be in this place of family that gives and takes and helps? It's just like what they did in Acts. They sold everything, brought it together for the good of the family. There are things that you can do. There's things that you carry. And it's not about what you don't have. That's never the right question. What do I have? That's the question I want to challenge you with you today also, is that what do you have that you can sow, big or small? It doesn't matter. Put it on the table. Let God use it. Let Him multiply. Number five, we find and obey God's strategy for this season. There's always a solution. He is a God of miracles. What is the strategy for this season? For your church, for you individually, for your family, for your business, for your community. What is God speaking? What is He doing in this time? Because there is great opportunity right now for us because of who God is and who we are as His children. We are the head and not the tail. We do have wisdom. We do have strategies that is far different than this world. And we need to pull that in this time. What's He saying? Man, this is my first video thing. It's not going to be perfect. We're doing a lot of Zoom things. People all over the world. I'm more connected than I ever have been because I'm living right now with, I need Your strategies, Lord, and I want to be intentional. How does that look? Mary Beth did that women's thing. We didn't want to just say, hey, you know what? We're not going to do it. It was like, what are You speaking? What can we do? What should we do? And then He's like, oh, you can still do this. Just do it in video form and give it to them. Now, here's an opportunity. You either take it or you don't. That's fine. That's not on our hands. We want to be obedient to what God's speaking. What is God speaking to you? Number six, we continue to be generous and sow what we need. The best question is, again, what do I have? It's not a time to hoard. It's not a time to be fearful. If you guys are gardening like I am getting ready to, hey, It's not going to happen unless I put some seed in the ground. It's not going to happen if I don't start my seeds. It's not going to happen if I don't go down to Lowe's and buy the plants that are already done. I have to have action in this season. And generosity with our time, our money, our resources, our gifts, our skills. And it could be as simple as this, writing a postcard, a note, texting somebody, emailing somebody, getting on the phone, doing a Skype. I don't know. I don't know your situation, but it's like I'm asking, Lord, what do I have? What can I do? And that's a really big thing. And I just wanted to say, it's going to be okay. You guys that are a lot older than me and a little bit older than me, we have gone through a lot of crisis in America and in this world. And what I do know is that eventually we will come through this. And my heart is that I'm better. I've grown. I've helped people. My three things are always to love, to connect, and encourage. Daily. How do I do that? This is a season where I've got kids home from school. I want to be intentional. My kids are older. I don't want to lose this opportunity in the midst of the chaos. There is some great opportunities if we're looking for opportunities. And it is easy at times to lose sight of the truth. So I want to speak a few verses over you, and then I want to declare a few things, and then I just want to say thank you. 1 Corinthians 10:13, no temptation has overtaken you except such as it is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. Philippians 1:6, be confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. John 16:33, those things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. John 11:25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection, the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Isaiah 45:17, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. In every tongue which rises against you in judgment, you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servant of the Lord, and the righteousness is from me, says the Lord. We've got to stay focused. And all last year, I got sucker punched. It was like a 2x4 hitting me. Just knocked the wind out of me. And there was days, to be honest with you guys, it was hard getting out of bed. Depression came in. Anxiety, fear, the what ifs. It was really hard. And when this whole thing started, we were just in the middle of helping people. And then about January, 3 or 4 months into this, it got personal. Because it just got personal. People started taking shots at us. People started saying stuff and doing stuff. And I know this. When 9/11 hit East Coast and we're on the West Coast, unless you had somebody that you knew or you lost something, it was devastating, but we had no skin in the game. It was kind of like we kind of went on with our life. And I challenge you in this crisis with the virus, if this has not affected you, please don't be numb. Get some skin in the game. If it hasn't affected you, great. You should be in a much better place than maybe a lot of people around you. How can you lift them up? How can you give them hope and encouragement? I want to declare five things over you. I love declaring God's word and stuff like this. But I want to declare five things over you real quick as we just land the plane here. I do not worry about anything, but in everything through prayer and thanksgiving, I possess the peace of God, which guards my heart and mind in Christ Jesus. That's based on Philippians 4:6-7. My love and service to others at this time is a powerful expression of God's love to everyone I meet. 1 Corinthians 13. God is comforting, strengthening, healing, and providing for those who have been negatively impacted by the coronavirus. 2 Corinthians 1, 3 through 4. I am a safe place for those around me. And my great faith covers and encourages those experiencing fear. Galatians 6, 1. My last one. My God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has delivered me in the past, and he will deliver me also and make me a source of strength and peace to others. 1 Samuel 17, 34 through 35. I just declare those things over you, no matter where you're at. God's bigger. He sees you. He loves you. He has a plan and a purpose that's far greater than you can imagine. I just want to encourage you. Lean into him. It's not my ways, but your ways, Lord. I don't understand. I've had that over and over. I don't understand, God. Please help. Please deliver. Please guide and direct and help me navigate through this so that I can be a tool in this season to bring hope and encouragement. Help me to stay anchored to you with both hands. Because if I'm hanging on to God here and I'm hanging on to the world here, there's a fight going on. But if I'm hanging on to Jesus and the kingdom and the principles here, then I'm in a much better place of letting go of other things. And here's the deal. It's not about being perfect. It's about growing and being in the process. And if there's things that are coming up in you, like I had, which is a whole nother message on trusting the Lord, it's when you get squeezed, you know what's inside. Maybe in this season, you're getting squeezed and there's things that are coming out that are ugly. Or your belief system is like, I know God's word and I can quote it, but in this situation, I'm not applying it and I'm running away from it. Don't let the enemy bring guilt, fear, or shame on you. Use it like a spiritual checkup. Dr. Jesus comes in the room and goes, hey, Seth, you're not as high a level of trust as you could be. So here's the deal. This is what I suggest you to do. You're at a 3 out of 10. You've got some ways to go. Do this daily, and we'll start watching it go up. That's a much better approach than feeling condemned and shamed. And then when you do that, you run away from the King of Kings, Daddy. You go hide and you go isolate yourself. And then you don't become the answer in this season. I bless you guys. I thank you. Pastor Ed, thank you for this opportunity. We love you guys. And we know that God's doing more than we can understand. And I look forward to hearing what he has done in this season and where he's taken each one of you. And just remember, we're still on this earth, so our job is still in front of us. There is no retirement in the kingdom. Just means it looks different. So find a way in this season. And there's little things that you can do, and there's big things that you can do. And don't underestimate it, because Jesus left the 99 to go after the one. And I'm looking for the one right now in this season like never before. The one I can bring hope to, the one I can encourage. And so bless you on your journey. We love you guys. Bye.
We lift our voices, we lift our voices.
Seth, Mary Beth, thank you. I wish you were here with us, not because of this potluck, but so that our church family could get to know you even better. Seth's message was challenging and time-worthy. I know we are all in different places in dealing with everything that's going on, but yes, you can. And yes, you will be able to endure. We will get through all of this. The light is at the end of the tunnel. You see, our hope is not anything this world has for us. It is in the Lord. Hold on to that this week. Find ways to connect to Him. Find ways to reach out to others. Let's continue to be the encouragers that we have been. Let's pray. Father, thank you for allowing us to again gather and worship you. Father, we're entering another week of dealing with this coronavirus pandemic, this stay-at-home order, and all the things that involves. I know tensions are getting tight and things are getting difficult for some. I ask, Father, your Spirit to be upon them, to strengthen them. I ask for your patience that you promised to give us. I thank you for your Spirit to be with us. Father, as we look forward to this next week, help us to keep our hearts open, our eyes open for opportunities to serve you, to encourage others, to provide the strength you've given us and the message of your love to flow into others. Father, we thank you. We thank you for all of this, and we thank you for your Son, who's made a relationship with you possible. Father, we pray this in his holy and precious name. Amen.